Hello and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where we have so much to talk about. Not just good news for Warner Brothers, ridiculously good news. I know all of you are waiting for that. We're gonna get to it in a moment. But also MGM has cause to celebrate this weekend, Bong Joon-ho. And while it's not so much good news for Gemini Man, that whole, let's say, situation is at least interesting. It's actually very interesting. And there's a bit of a silver lining to that dark cloud for Mr. Will Smith. But of course, let's start with Joker, where we can utilize yet another quote from the movie to talk about DC movies as a whole. By the way, the argument for a best screenplay nomination, I believe it would still be adapted because it's based on the comics, even though it's not based on a particular story from the comics. And Scorsese's probably like, hell yeah, it's adapted. But anyway, the argument for a screenplay nomination is becoming more and more convincing, right? It's this, as the movie settles in, so many great quotes. But the one I want to reference here is where Arthur says, "For my whole life, I didn't know if I even really existed, but I do, and people are starting to notice." DC movies? Oh, it's so great! Yes, Joker, which has now hit every country it's going to hit, rallied tremendously over the weekend. Wow, it really is dancing down those stairs, right? A second weekend drop in the low 40s, pretty much unheard of for blockbusters, especially ones that open as big as Joker did. For instance, Edge of Tomorrow had a similar second weekend hold, but it didn't open as big as Joker. And in just 2 weeks, Joker has blown past 500 million worldwide. It's way past 500 million. That not only makes it likely that Joker will unseat Deadpool as the highest grossing R-rated film of all time, but it puts the billion-dollar club in play. I know some of you are like, it was always in play, Grace. And maybe in some ways it was, because the trailer was just so damn hot. But the Suicide Squad trailers were hot, and that didn't get to a billion. It got pretty high, because those trailers were so hot. Some people liked it, but some people just couldn't believe it wasn't good. But anyway, this is amazing. And I think the billion-dollar club is now legitimately in play. Very in play, because everyone's talking about Joker. It's becoming a must-see movie, even for people who didn't have any interest in seeing it originally. So it's that conversation is driving people to the multiplexes to check it out for themselves, plus repeat business, as we expected, is absolutely phenomenal. And get this, if Joker does make it into the billion-dollar club, it would be the cheapest film by far ever to do so. Wow, Todd Phillips is probably like so popular right now. Is he? I think he is. There are some people, you know, DC is always going to have a mixed bag because some people just really have it out for them. Maybe that's why Marty's so testy lately about comic book movies, because he feels like he is a large part responsible for this. At one point, he was an executive producer on it. Maybe he shouldn't have dropped out. But, you know, I think Todd Phillips deserves all the acclaim that is warranted for such a phenomenal success. Now, what's more is that all this heat is quickly cementing Joker as another The Dark Knight. And I know some of you are like, you're not going to compare Todd Phillips to Christopher Nolan again, are you, Grace? Well, I don't need to, because the comparison at this point is obvious. But what I'm talking about is significantly helping Joker's Oscar chances, because the Academy is still haunted to this day. The whole reason there is a 10 picture, they can go up to 10 pictures for Best Picture, is because they didn't have enough room for The Dark Knight. Yeah, that was the problem. You guys were just jerks about it. But anyway, because, you know, other great comic book movies haven't made it into the top, those 10 spots like Wonder Woman or Logan, so I don't want to hear it. But anyway, the Academy is still haunted to this day for not nominating The Dark Knight for Best Picture. So they're not going to want a repeat of that, right? They didn't nominate The Dark Knight in any of the major categories, in fact. Only Heath Ledger, you know, I'm talking about outside of the craft categories. Heath Ledger was nominated and won, but I think that was partially due to, well, not only his incredible performance. He was certainly, I think he deserved the nomination and the win, but I think his death, of course, was a factor. So the Academy isn't going to want a repeat of that, as I said. Plus, nominating Joker will help with a little thing called ratings. Help the Academy desperately could use. I wonder how Disney feels about this, because, of course, the Oscars air on ABC. But I think this is just going to be such a ratings juggernaut for them. They'll be okay with it. And also, they can mandate what ads might play during the Oscars. No Netflix ads. But I don't... And they almost mandated who the hosts were. But I don't think we're at the nominees just yet. So anyway, expect nominations for not only Joaquin Phoenix, but I would suspect Best Picture, Adapted Screenplay, and maybe even Director. I think Cinematography as well, but The Dark Knight was nominated in that category too. Now, last year, Black Panther, of course, pretty much only in the craft categories, but it got a lot of them, right? And now this year, it looks like Joker? That's incredible. But also, I have to say, Joker's strength pretty much makes Avengers Endgame's Oscar campaign, outside of categories like VFX, a non-starter. They're, of course, campaigning very hard for a screenwriting nomination as well. And I thought the way that movie was put together, Avengers Endgame, was very impressive. But I think it's incredibly unlikely we'll see two comic book movies nominated for Best Screenplay. So I wonder, which one would you go with? I think that I would have to go with Joker because of the commentary on... It's such a commentary on society, whereas Avengers Endgame is just very well put together from like a nuts and bolts industry and a fun perspective. But it doesn't have that social commentary that Joker does, which is the stuff of awards, right? That's what they always say. So time to, you know, to make good on that when a comic book movie does it. And by the way, guess what? This is so brilliant. This is all coming together beautifully. So Joker will likely hit streaming just in time for award season, which means it will blow up in the ancillary market, making even more money for Warner Brothers. But as we discussed last weekend, Joker's tremendous success is a bit of a problem for Warner Brothers. I mean, clearly after The Dark Knight and now Joker, the studio has received a crystal clear mandate from audiences of the type of film, DC film, that audiences want to see. Yes, in just 2 weeks, Joker is already number 9 when it comes to all DC movies, not just the DCEU. Not adjusted for inflation, though. Yet multiple DC projects are already rolling full steam ahead with no connection to Joker and even very different in tone from Joker. So what's Warner Brothers to do? Remember, Hollywood is a business, and ideally, every DC movie would perform like this. You know, like every MCU movie does, right? Also, let's note that DC movies continue to shine when they're not like the MCU, with Aquaman, though, being the lone exception to that rule. I still thought Aquaman was pretty gritty, though. I thought it had gritty aspects to it. So I think it very firmly has one foot in the Marvel tone situation. I still believe Aquaman, in addition to being a really good movie, one of the reasons it did so well is because of the IMAX 3D experience and how good a job they did bringing this the underwater world to life. That was something, it was a little like Avatar in that regard. That was something new to enjoy and had not been done before. So good luck, Little Mermaid movie. All right, so as for a Joker sequel, don't expect that announcement, I would say, now until after the Oscars on February 9th, 2020. Because Joker is becoming such a big deal, I think that a sequel announcement would likely undercut Joker's artistic credibility with some voters. I think the other voters who'd be okay with it pretty much know it's going to happen anyway. Because a sequel announcement would be a great way to celebrate some big wins, don't you think? Phillips is supposed to make that Hulk Hogan bio starring Chris Hemsworth next for Netflix. I wonder if he still does that. I don't know. That seems like it could be a misstep to me. And then Joaquin Phoenix is set to reteam with Casey Affleck on another movie, Affleck directing as he did the last time. But overall, their schedules are pretty open, and I think Joker 2 is going to happen. I mean, Joaquin Phoenix is already talking about it, because of course he is. All right, next, MGM. Sorry, that's all the Joker discussion, but I'm sure we'll be talking about Joker, as I said, all the way through awards season. And then for the sequel, it's very exciting stuff. All right, and Joaquin Phoenix loves being the center of attention, as he should and as he deserves to be. Now, next, MGM made a... Because, like, here's the thing. Sorry, Addams Family, we'll get to you in a minute. It was so frustrating to see the success of The Dark Knight slip through not only Warner Brothers' fingers, but the fingers of the fans, of the DC viewers, right? We're like, look what we once were. Ah, it's like those banished societies that remember how great things were before they fell into the sea like Atlantis, right? And you're like, oh, remember how great we once were? We're a fallen empire. And everyone's like, sure, whatever. But see, it is amazing. So I would be very frustrated if Warner Brothers and DC allowed that to happen a second time. Because, like, I can't believe they actually after spectacularly letting that slip through their fingers the first time around, they actually managed to find themselves back in the same position again. From the money, to the fan appreciation, to even the awards worthiness. It's, you never would have thought it would happen twice. Lightning has literally struck twice. So let's see what happens. But it's, let's see. All right, so anyway, Addams Family. So MGM made a play to be this year's Hotel Transylvania or Goosebumps and also succeeded wildly, albeit on a much smaller scale. But it's pretty darn good for MGM, as this was by far the biggest opening of the for the studio of the year, as it got a head start in the Halloween season for families. Addams Family got a B+ cinema score, which means it should be a genuine competitor for Maleficent 2 this coming weekend, because both Hotel Transylvania movies, when they opened in October, dropped in just the 30 percentile each week for the entire month. Then Gemini Man, which also got a B+ from audiences. Suspicious. I think it was the 26% Rotten Tomatoes score, which was a deal breaker for many. Which is odd, though, because Joker only has a 68%, and movies like Aquaman and Venom had very low RT scores. So it's clear sometimes audiences ignore Rotten Tomatoes. But maybe that's only with comic book movies, as a lot of fans, I think, can see clearly that critics aren't maybe so fair to those films. Although also everybody ignored it for The Greatest Showman. So, I think Gemini Man, because of the technological advancements, deserves to be in that group. But it's not. And what's interesting to me is that it might be that Will Smith's career is perhaps not as resurrected as we had thought it was. Because over the past few years, this would actually be a pretty typical opening for Smith. Now, fascinatingly, 61% of the audience was under 35. That's big. Perhaps a sign that older moviegoers weren't willing to try out or were excited about the new technology. Also, very unusual, the African-American and Caucasian turnout was tied, showing tremendous support from the African-American community for Smith, something he has not always enjoyed himself. He should stroll over to the newly opened Tyler Perry Studios, where there's a soundstage named after him, and take some pics and video with Perry and around the lot. Post it on YouTube, Will! I think that would be a great next step. Then Parasite made headlines on Friday, when, in limited release, it sold out every single showing for the weekend at New York City's IFC Center. By Friday morning, for the weekend that was coming up, and it was playing a lot of times each day. And it was playing in just 3 theaters across the entire United States, 2 in Los Angeles, 1 in New York, which is pretty typical for a movie that debuts. It's usually 2 and 2, but this was 1 and 2. But anyway, Parasite topped The Farewell, another Asian foreign language film, for the best debut per screen average of the year. Parasite, after being the number one film at Cannes, is pretty much a lock for a best foreign film nomination, and probably even the win. So the big question has become, can it show up in any other categories? It's looking pretty good, although I do think The Farewell is a strong competitor. And that, you know, I wonder if Parasite and Joker might cancel each other out a little bit, because The Farewell is like a happier, more like a warmer film, and that would, I think, create a little bit more of a wider scope to the type of films that are nominated. If I were the Farewell team, that's what I'd be whispering around town. All right, so as for the weekend overall, at least Jexi managed to open in the top 10, even if just barely. Judy boasted the best hold of the weekend, while Hustlers became the biggest hit, not including voiceover work, of Jennifer Lopez's career, topping 2002's Made in Manhattan. As for this coming weekend, Maleficent 2 will try to sell itself as a Halloween movie. A little late for that, because most of the movie doesn't look very Halloween-y, no matter what they do to the posters. But it is still expected to take first place, while Zombieland 2 will fight it out with Joker for second place. Jojo Rabbit and The Lighthouse will both open in limited release and hope to post their own strong per-theater average headlines, and maybe even, I don't know if they can break Parasites. That's amazing. But they're going to try and get awfully close, right? At least they're going to enter they'll break into the next stages of their own awards races or campaigns. All right, so that's this week's Movie Math. Thanks for going over the box office with me. Share your thoughts down below. Be sure to hit that subscribe button. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.